These two IoT sensor boards has taught me a valuable lesson in what my time costs between DIY and turnkey assembly. So in this video, I show you the design of this sensor feather wing, the wrong way to build it, the right way, how the turn on went, and some insights I learned about my garden. This video is sponsored by MacroFab. In a past project, I wanted to capture the environmental data of my, at the time, new lab, and then store it on something like Home Assistant. I created a board with temperature, humidity, light, and sound sensors. I picked these particular sensors because I had breakout boards for them, and I knew that Adafruit had example code for all of them to make getting started easier. Speaking of Adafruit, I decided on their feather form factor because it is compact and comes in so many variations. One thing I noticed is that some microcontroller boards have micro SD card sockets and some have radios, but I do not think any have both. So for flexibility, I added a real-time clock and micro SD card socket to my feather wing. Adding the RTC bothered me a little bit because most microcontrollers, especially 32-bit microcontrollers, have an RTC built in already. However, not all of the feathers have a 32 kHz clock or the pins broken out to add one. I got the first boards manufactured, but decided to use my DIY assembly process. I used a polyimid stencil, which works well for SOIC and 0805 components. However, QFN and other fine pitch parts are an issue. Between the film stencil and my lacking techniques, I really struggled to get good prints of the solder paste, especially around the critical sensors. My bulb pick and place machine is slow and prone to mistakes, but at least it is free because I pay myself $0 per hour, sometimes even less. For soldering, I have a super advanced reflow oven with a custom controller based on a solid state relay. Again, for SOIC and 0805 footprints, this setup works really well. Today, I normally use it with bismuth solder, which has a low melting point. Despite being a crude method, I still get to watch the magic surface mount reflow action happen. The biggest downside to my DIY approach is I almost always have to do rework on every single one of the boards. For example, one of my first checks is always to see if there are shorts on the power rails, which... Well, crap. Jumping ahead of a whole bunch of hours of doing rework, I got one board to work successfully. However, I did notice a very slight problem with the layout.
What?
Yep, I totally missed that. Since then, I have definitely learned the value of using 3D models, especially if you can get them from the vendor, when doing PCB layout. Eventually, I got the code working with everything but the microphone. Now, you might notice the date on the RTC timestamp. Yeah, so I basically put this project down for years because after 30 or 40 hours of rework and making a second revision, I only had two functional wings. Now, I still had other problems with the second revision, and I really needed a better way to build them. Years ago, I did a series on making a custom Arduino board. I showed how to design the PCB in the shape of a triangle and called it Pyramiduino, for some reason. I paid for MacroFab's turnkey assembly services to build a set of these boards for me, and I gave some away to Patreon members. Instead of just repeating that project, when MacroFab offered to sponsor a video, I decided to bring back my Bald Sense project. My first step was to clean up a few other mistakes on the schematic. Plus, I have finally learned to use and pass KiCad's ERC. Over on the PCB, I made sure, multiple times, that the SD card socket was correct. I also converted the design to a four-layer board. That way, I could have an inner layer of ground and one for the power rails. DRC did not like the spacing of the teeny pads for the sensors, but that's why I wanted to go with a turnkey service anyway. So, I headed over to MacroFab, created a project for Bald Sense, and uploaded my KiCad PCB file. Astute viewers might notice that board looks a little different than it did in KiCad. In KiCad, I noticed that the edge cuts layer had different thicknesses for the curved edges. This was before you could add fillets to shapes. I fixed those and then I generated Gerbers for the design. MacroFab's uploader is smart enough that I can just upload the updated edge cut layer and it updates the project accordingly. After giving the other layers a look, I went to the PCB options and only changed the UL marking setting. I left everything else, like the surface finish, as the default. Here, I uploaded an Excel file with all of my parts. The charts and graphs on top help illustrate the status of the overall BOM. Yeah, so a little bit of sleight of hand there. I didn't actually export a BOM from KiCad. I'm still learning how to use the new exporter on KiCad 8. Instead, I just let MacroFab scrape the data from the PCB file. And so on the first pass, I went through and assigned passives to be house parts and double checked that the ICs were the correct part numbers for their package. When that was done, I exported a spreadsheet version to use later, or before. That said, the process was straightforward, and on a relatively small board like this one, it did not take that long to assign valid part numbers. It did turn out that the bill of materials cost is a little bit high because parts like the light sensor are no longer in production. However, as long as a major distributor has stock, MacroFab can source the components, like in this case. That said, all I had to do at this point was get an automated quote and then fill out the billing information. The process was entirely frictionless. In fact, I never communicated with anybody other than the automated emails that they sent me. MacroFab's online tools provide real-time quotes, which help you visualize the cost based on quantity and delivery time. Their platform connects to a vast network of manufacturing facilities and capabilities, no matter the scale of your project. Throughout the process, I received regular updates which required almost no action on my part. Join me and thousands of engineers by using the link below to learn more and start your project today. Now, even though I used their 10-day service, I didn't receive the boards for 11 days. Dun, dun, dun! But that is because a hurricane hit Houston and UPS delayed the shipment once they had it. Which, if that didn't happen, then I might have actually received the boards a day early. As expected, the boards were packed well, and I was really excited to see the first one because it looked so great. Looking at it made me realize that Turnkey was the way to go. To get started, I soldered headers as fast as I could. By the way, I dedicated this breadboard to soldering headers since it helps to make them straight and even. I also made sure to solder the jumper for the power LED. I have finally learned a trick for solder jumpers, which is I drop my iron down to about 250 degrees for 10 lead solder, and then I make the bubble. If it's not very clean looking, then I add a drop of flux and hit it again. The overall result is satisfying. For my initial power on, I connected the board to a Bus Pirate 5. It connects over USB serial. Doing an I2C scan should return addresses, but I got nothing. Then I remembered I designed in a load switch for all of the devices, which means I need to turn on its enable and then scan again. Now we're seeing all of the I2C devices, which made me happy. For my initial testing, I decided to mate the board to something called a FeatherS3. By the way, Unexpected Maker sent me some of these feathers for free, and they are awesome. These ESP32S3 boards can run any ESP32 firmware, but they come preloaded with CircuitPython. Long term, I'll end up with an RTOS like Zephyr. For now, CircuitPython will make it fast to test the boards as well as get started with my code. In fact, in less than a day, I was talking to the temperature and light sensors, the microSD card, and the RTC. The analog, battery, and USB measurements worked as expected as well. However, like before, I ran into a snag with the PDM microphone. While the ESP32S3 has hardware support for pulse density modulation, or PDM, CircuitPython does not. Since that one has to wait, I turned my focus to Wi-Fi and MQTT, which of course took very little effort. Once I could send messages to a broker and save them to the SD card, I reworked the code to support a deep sleep state. Since this is CircuitPython, I was a little bit worried about current consumption. So, I connected a Nordic Power Profiler kit. These measure current consumption of a device that it's connected to. My capture cycles look like they're taking an average of about 100 milliamps. And if you look at the rest of the waveform, you can get a sense of what's going on in the code just by the current consumption. Now, when the ESP goes to sleep, it draws 1 to 2 milliamps, which is kind of high. Without rewriting the code in C++, there's already tons of optimizations I could do. For example, right now, I turn on the Wi-Fi radio and then go make the sensor readings, instead of getting the readings and then turning on the radio. But for now, I'm very happy with what it can do. So it was time to do some testing. I put the boards and the battery into an off-the-shelf plastic container and placed it in my garden. Immediately, I ran into a problem. The ESP never talked to my MQTT broker. Using a Flipper Zero, I could see why. There was only one access point available where I put the bald sense, and it's not the one I told it to use. So I changed that and then started getting data. And very soon I realized a dumb mistake. I knew the temperature sensor would measure the rise of the PCB and the air inside the box, but I completely overlooked the effect of the sun. Of course, in direct sunlight, most of the temperature readings are going to be useless. While that test ran, I designed and printed a custom enclosure. I also changed the data interval from 10 seconds to once every 10 minutes and fixed a few other things in code. Last, I put the IoT device in a shady spot. For the past couple of days, I've grabbed a lot of log files with IoT data. And just for the moment, I threw one of those log files into Grafana. other than the environmental data I expected, I saw something interesting. Both of the analog ADC readings drift significantly when the temperature inside the box is above 70 degrees Celsius. But we have to come back to that in a later video. Overall, I'm really happy with the way that BaldSense has turned out. It is a highly flexible sensor platform with some very good sensors. I have a bunch of ideas on how I want to use this project in the future. For now, I've achieved my first goal. By using MacroFab's turnkey services, the BaldSense Featherwing is finally functional. And thanks to rapid programming tools like CircuitPython, I am collecting sensor data and transmitting it to a broker. At this point, I can start to think about what I can do with that data next. Hi, I'm James. Thanks for watching another video. Now, while I do like my DIY methods, in the future, I'm going to use turnkey assembly services more. If you'd like to give MacroFab a try, use the link below to upload a project and get started today.